first moment, like Matt said, that we're going to talk about is Palm Sunday, which is today. And today is a really, really important, significant day, because like Matt said, it's the day that Jesus entered the city of Jerusalem, the city where he would be crucified and rise from the grave. And this is a day that's exactly a week before Easter. And really, this day, this moment, kind of set in motion all of the events that we're going to talk about today. And really, this day is the beginning of something that changed everything. So Palm Sunday, on the morning of Palm Sunday, Jesus says to two of his disciples, he says, hey, go to the village and untie a baby donkey and bring that back to me, one that's never been ridden on before. And if anybody gives you trouble, just tell them it's for the Lord. So the disciples go to the village and they start untying a donkey, and people are like, what are you doing? They're like, oh, this donkey is for the Lord. And they bring it back to Jesus. And they put a cloak over the donkey, and Jesus gets on top. And the reason why this is important for you to know is because this is how royalty entered the city. This is how a king entered the city, on a donkey that's never been touched before, a donkey that's never been ridden on before. So it was the symbol of who Jesus is. And the thing that's really, really important for you to understand about this moment of Jesus entering the city of Jerusalem is, for the most part, Jesus kind of laid low in his ministry. He wasn't shouting things from the rooftops. Yes, he taught. Yes, he performed miracles. And there was a lot of word of mouth and a lot of things that Jesus was doing. But things had been fairly, low key until this moment. See, this is the moment, the first moment, where Jesus is really proclaiming who he is, saying that, telling everybody that he is the Messiah, he is our promised one, and he is riding into the city, allowing people to kind of shout that from the rooftops for the very first time. So as Jesus begins to ride into the city of Jerusalem, again, on a donkey, the streets begin to line with crowds, and people begin cheering for him and yelling things out like, Hosanna! Or they're yelling things out like, blessed be the Son of David. And people are cheering for him. And not only are they cheering for him, that they're laying things at the donkey's feet. So because, again, he's coming in the way that a king would come in, the way that royalty would come in, people were laying down tree branches so that the donkey's feet didn't touch the dirt. And they're laying down their cloaks and things that they had and garments onto the ground so that even the donkey wasn't touching the dirt. And they were screaming out and yelling things out because they believed he was their savior. Now, some of them believed that he was their true savior, the King of Kings, the promised Messiah from God. And so they were cheering out for him because they knew what it meant that Jesus was coming into the city. But most of the people believed he was a different kind of savior. See, they thought Jesus was just a king who was going to come and save them from their current circumstances, from the Romans. And so they're cheering for him as well because they believe that he's going to do something significant, but just not what Jesus came to do. And as Jesus is riding in on the donkey, he begins to weep. He begins to cry because in the crowd, there are few that know who he really is. But most of the people who are cheering for him, in a few days' time, Jesus knows they're going to be cheering something else out at him. That right now they're saying, bless you and praise him. But in a few days, they're going to be saying, murder him and crucify him. And so Jesus knows that when he's entering into this city, he's entering into this city to fulfill this promise of dying on the cross. So today, Palm Sunday, is this day of celebration because, again, it sets in motion everything that we're going to talk about today and this moment where Jesus is proclaiming that he is Messiah as he rides into Jerusalem.
We're going to have you guys stand up. We're going to sing out a song called The Way. You guys can kind of scoot this way a little bit. But we're going to sing out this song called The Way, and we're going to declare who Jesus is and that Jesus is that perfect sacrifice. And so we're going to sing this out. From the grave I've been raised. Oh, 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 when I needed a savior to save me, Jesus, you made a way.
All right, guys, this is the scene of the Last Supper. And when you think of the Last Supper, I want you guys to think of this table and think of Jesus and the disciples sitting around this table. Now, Jesus loved his disciples. He mentored them and taught them and loved them deeply. So I imagine that any time Jesus and the disciples were together, that it was like life group, that it was fun and that the mood was great. They were having a good time swapping stories and maybe sharing their highs and lows of the day. But for this specific occasion, I picture the mood being a little somber and the room kind of being dark like this and the air being a little anxious because the disciples all knew that so many men wanted Jesus killed. So the Last Supper that these men are partaking in is also called Passover. And for those of you who don't know what Passover is, it's something that the Jews have celebrated since the time of Moses when the Lord saved the Israelite babies. The Israelites were instructed to put the blood of a lamb above their doorways, and this visual was a sign for the Lord to pass over these homes and keep them safe. But right here at this specific occasion, it's so significant because Jesus is telling the disciples that he's about to become the Passover Lamb of God. He's going to sacrifice himself, and his blood is going to be shed so that you and I, when we choose to accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we're passed over, and we're offered eternal life in God's kingdom. So for the rest of the night, Jesus spent time with the disciples, and he wanted to communicate something really important that was taking place the next day. And I want to share this with you, but I have this awesome video that I think is a really good visual of what this probably looked like. So why don't you guys look to the screens and check this out?
Don't be afraid. Trust in God. Trust in me also. You know the way to where I'm going.
We don't know where you're going. How can we know the way?
I am the way. The truth. And the life. This is my body. This is my blood. Remember me. doing this. I'm going to the Father, but I will always be with you.
So Jesus took the bread, and he said, "This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then he took the glass of wine, or grape juice in JHM, and he said, "This is my blood poured out for many so that their sins may be forgiven." And you guys, this is communion. This is what you and I do when we choose to remember, and this is something that the disciples did a long, long time ago. So when you think of the Last Supper, picture this table. Picture this intimate moment where Jesus is sitting with the disciples, sharing with them about what's going to be taking place the next day.
All right, you guys, why don't you come scoot back here, scoot nice and close, get as close as you can. So when Jesus and his disciples had finished eating, just like you guys are kind of doing right now, they headed from the Last Supper to the Garden of Gethsemane. And the Garden of Gethsemane was one of Jesus' favorite places to be alone with God and pray. And so when they get there, he walks off just a little distance by himself. The Bible says a stone's throw away, which is probably about from me to you. And he kneels down on the ground and he starts praying. And at this point, Jesus knows what's coming. He knows that the road ahead is going to be hard and there's going to be suffering. And so he kneels down and he says, "Father, if you're willing, please take this cup of suffering away from me." And I'm a visual person, so this is what I picture when Jesus is praying this prayer. He's looking ahead, and he's looking ahead at what's about to happen. And he knows that he's about to be betrayed by a friend. And he knows that because of this betrayal, he's going to be arrested, and he's going to be tortured, and he's going to suffer. And he knows that he's going to be humiliated. And he knows that at the end of all of it, he's going to be crucified. Ooh, you guys, I can smell this. It's super gross. How many of you would want to drink this? Probably not many of you, right? It's super gross. Well, at the end, like, he's looking, as he's praying this prayer, he's looking ahead at what's about to happen. And he sees this cup of bitterness and grossness and suffering and all this stuff. And so he says, "Father, if you're willing, please take this cup of suffering away." Right? He's saying, if there's any other way, let's do it that way. But then he prays something crazy and something awesome and something that shows us his heart. He says, "Father, if you're willing, please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet, I want your will to be done and not mine." He says, "Father, if there's any other way, let's do it that way. But what you want is more important than what I want. And your will and your desire is my will and my desire." Because he knows that even though there's going to be pain, and even though it's going to hurt and there's going to be suffering, he knows that what he's about to do is going to change everything. That what he's about to do is going to change everything for all of us. And you guys, I think that when Jesus is praying this prayer in the garden, when he's saying, "Your will be done," I think that he had you and me in mind. Personally, you and me in mind. Because when he's praying this prayer, he knows that even though it means pain and suffering and hurt and even death for himself, he knew that it would mean life for us. And when he prays this, "Your will be done" prayer, I think it shows us a couple cool things about Jesus' heart. It shows us that, first of all, he loves God enough to say, "I'm willing to do anything. I'm willing to suffer, and I'm even willing to die so that your kingdom and your will be realized on earth." But it also shows us how much he loves us, that he loves us to take this cup of suffering. He's going to say, "Yeah, I'm going to drink the whole thing. I'm going to let it be poured out on me down to the very last drop so that we wouldn't have to." Because this is our cup of suffering, our cup of suffering. But he was willing to drink the whole thing down to the last drop. And this shows us how much he loves us and how much he cares for us. And so Jesus prays this prayer, and he stays there praying for a while longer and summoning the courage and the strength that he's going to need for the road ahead. And the Bible says that he was so anxious that his sweat was falling to the ground like great drops of blood. Can you imagine being that anxious? So Jesus prays for a while, and then when he's finished, he gets up and he heads back to his disciples, only to find that they had fallen asleep, because the disciples knew that their time with Jesus was coming to an end as well, and they were sad about that, and they were grieving, and so they were tired and had fallen asleep. So Jesus says, "Get up and pray," because he knew that his trials and their trials were about to start.
Well, you guys can stand back up, and we're going to sing another song. This song is called Fortress, and it's about God being our strength and our stronghold. And so we're going to sing about that and declare that through this next song. So sing this out with us.
Okay, you guys, in this scene changes everything from here on out. This is the major plot twist, the turning point. So meet Judas. He's one of Jesus' best friends. He's one of the 12 disciples. And so Judas is the one who takes care of all the money. So if they need to buy anything or someone wants to give them money, they go to him. He's the treasurer. And he's kind of a big deal for holding on to all that money for Jesus. And so Judas travels around with all the disciples and Jesus. So he loves them deeply. This gets hard, though. So everyone has it out for Jesus at this point. Well, actually, they have it out for anybody who comes in contact with Jesus, including Judas. So this pressure builds on him over and over again every day for all these people having it out on him. And so one day, Judas overhears these guards talking about how they're willing to pay big bucks to anybody who tells them who Jesus is. Whoever points out who Jesus is, they will give them a big reward. And so, Judas overhears this and he kind of contemplates it. He's stuck. Jesus was his friend, one of his best friends. But this was a big reward. And so, he thought about it and he thought about it. And so when it came to the Passover, he decided to skip out. He decided to go and tell the guards that he knew who Jesus was. And that if they were to follow him and enter back into the garden, he'll greet Jesus with a kiss on the cheek and show them who he is. And so this kiss would symbolize this is Jesus and kind of rat him out at that point. So as Jesus and all the disciples are getting Passover ready and are back in the garden, Judas comes back with the guards. He greets Jesus with the kiss. And at that point, you guys, Jesus knew. Jesus knew that he was being betrayed. And so the guards come and they start tying Jesus up and everyone's confused and mad and just so angry for Judas betraying Jesus. Peter, one of the other disciples, gets so angry that he actually chops off one of the guards' ears. But Jesus stands there graciously. He puts the ear back on and heals the man right then and there. And the guards start taking him away. At that point, Judas was like, easy money. That was so easy. Jesus didn't do anything wrong anyways. They're probably just going to go and they're going to let him go right away because he didn't do anything wrong. They're not going to put him on trial, he thought. But he was wrong. They put him on trial and they went through that whole process with him and he had no idea that he was ratting Jesus out. And so he felt really bad. He not only betrayed Jesus, the Savior of the world, his best friend, the Lord, but he betrayed his disciples too, his brothers, the people he loved so deeply, he betrayed right then and there. He was so angry at himself. He was so confused on why he would ever even do that in the first place. And so while he was sitting there, he knew it all just started sinking in as Jesus left that he did something wrong. And he stood there saying, "What have I done? What have I done?"
All right, and you guys are going to come way over here to the other side of the room now. I know, it's a long walk. All right, now after all of these things have already taken place and the stations you've been to have already happened, the religious leaders, they took Jesus to the Roman governor because they knew that the Roman government were the only ones that could put anybody to death. And at this time, the governor, his name was Pilate. And so the religious leaders are dragging Jesus and they're bringing him to Pilate. And when they do that, they're like screaming these accusations to Pilate about Jesus. Some of the things they're saying are true. Like, this man is saying that he's king. Well, yeah, he was doing that. And some of the things that they were shouting were so false because they wanted to do anything that they could to put Jesus to death. Now, Pilate was so confused, like, what has he done? It doesn't make sense, all the things that you're saying. And the only thing that he could think of why these people wanted Jesus to be put to death was that the religious leaders were jealous. And so Pilate, he turns to Jesus and he says, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus replied, "You have said it yourself." And so after that, they're still like screaming at Jesus and saying all these accusations and all these things. And Pilate looks at Jesus and he said, "Why aren't you defending yourself? Why aren't you just answering their questions? Say something. If you would say something, then maybe I could save you." And to Pilate's astonishment, Jesus just sat and he took it all and he said nothing. So Pilate turned to the men and he told the men, "This man seems to be innocent. I can't find anything wrong with what he's done." And now you need to know that back during this time, there was a tradition. So every year during the Passover celebration, they let one man out of jail for free. So it's like a legit get out of jail free card. And it happens every year at this time. And it was the people that were able to decide who was released that year. And so Pilate looked and pleaded with the men and said, "I think that Jesus should be released. What do you think?" And so the religious leaders kind of had a hum among the crowd, and they started chanting, "No, we don't want Jesus released. You need to release Barabbas." And then the whole crowd started cheering, "Give us Barabbas, give us Barabbas." Now, Barabbas was a man that was in jail because he had committed murder. And Barabbas was set to be crucified. And this is the man that they wanted released from jail. This is how much they hated or feared who Jesus was. Now, as you can imagine during this time, Pilate was really confused. And so he said, "Fine, I'll release Barabbas. But what do I do with this man called Jesus?" And the crowd started cheering, "Crucify him." And Pilate said, "Well, what crime has he committed?" And they started chanting, "Crucify him, crucify him." And so Pilate was so torn. At one point, he didn't want to put an innocent man to death. But at another, he had this mob, this riot that was rising, and they were angry, and all they wanted was Jesus to be dead. And so Pilate decided, "Well, maybe if I have Jesus beaten, if I have Jesus whipped, then that will settle this crowd down, and that will be enough to suffice." And so that's what he did. So Pilate had Jesus whipped 39 times. And as he was being whipped, as his back was being torn, all the crowd was doing was yelling, "Crucify him." There was nobody that was feeling bad for Jesus. They just wanted him dead in that moment. And so Pilate knew, "I don't think anything is going to help. It just keeps getting crazier. The mob just keeps getting angrier, and I have to make a decision." And I think you guys can relate to some of the peer pressure that Pilate was feeling in this moment. And so Pilate went, and he made his decision. And so he ordered somebody to grab a water basin for him, and he began to wash his hands. And as he was washing his hands in this basin, he said this. He said, "I'm innocent of this man's blood. I'm washing my hands of everything that is happening here. I don't want this man's blood on my hands. My hands are clean. The execution of this man is on you." And then he ordered Jesus to go and be crucified.
You guys can make your way over here. Scoot over just a little bit. So after Pilate handed Jesus over to be crucified, they forced Jesus to carry part of his cross through the city. Keep in mind, he'd already been beaten 39 times, basically within inches of his life. And now they're forcing him to carry this heavy wooden cross through the city. And Jesus was stumbling and struggling, as you can see in that video, to carry the cross. And so one of the guards pulled a man from the crowd named Simon. They forced Simon to carry Jesus' cross for him. And eventually they got to the place where Jesus was to be crucified. It was a place called Golgotha, which in Aramaic means the place of the skull. And it's called that because the hillside looks like a skull, like a face of a skull. Here's a picture of what most people think was Golgotha. This is the site where they most likely was. And you can kind of see at the bottom, those two little indents in the hill look like kind of eyes of a skull. And they chose this place to crucify Jesus because it was up on a hill. and it was next to a major road, and so many people who were passing by would have seen it. And as they got there, eventually when they got to the place, Golgotha, they laid Jesus down on the cross, and they drove a nail through each of his hands and then through both of his feet, and then they stood the cross up. On either side of Jesus, there were two other criminals that were crucified along with him, and these were criminals who were convicted of other crimes. Maybe you've seen pictures of the three crosses on the hillside. That's because there's two other people crucified with Jesus. One of the criminals started mocking Jesus as they were hanging there, and he said, "Jesus, aren't you the Messiah? Can't you save yourself? Why don't you just save us? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal recognized who Jesus was. He knew he was the Messiah. He knew he was innocent. And so he said to Jesus, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." So to this man, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." As Jesus was hanging there, the guards started casting dice. They were gambling for Jesus' clothes. And that fulfilled a prophecy in Psalm 22, which says that they cast lots for my clothing. And eventually Jesus got thirsty, and he asked for something to drink. But the only thing that they had around was this jar full of sour wine, basically like vinegar. And somebody soaked a sponge in the sour wine and put it on a stick and held it up to Jesus' lips. And when Jesus touched it, when it touched his lips, it says in John 19:30, when Jesus had tasted it, he said, "It is finished." And then he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. And at the moment that Jesus died, the Bible says that in the temple in Jerusalem, that the curtain that was in the Holy of Holies, the most holy place in the very center of the temple, the curtain was torn in two from top to bottom. And it said that the whole earth shook like an earthquake when Jesus died. Now the guards had to stand by during crucifixions to make sure and to guard the people who were being crucified, to make sure that nobody would come and take them down before they were dead. And so they had to stand there the whole time. And so to speed the process up, a lot of times what they would do is they would break the legs of the people hanging on the cross. Because believe it or not, the way that you died when you were crucified was through suffocation. Because in order to take a breath as you're hanging there, you had to push yourself up with your legs to raise your chest up so you could inhale. That was the only way that you could breathe. And so the guards would oftentimes, to speed up the process of death, they would break the legs of the people hanging on the cross so they wouldn't be able to push themselves up, and they would eventually suffocate. So the guards, they went to the two other criminals, and they broke their legs so that they would die. But then when they got to Jesus, they saw that Jesus was already dead. So rather than breaking his legs, they took a spear, and just to make sure, they pierced him in his side. And the Bible says that when they did that, blood and water flowed out from Jesus' side. And that fulfilled a couple more prophecies from the Old Testament that said that they wouldn't break his bones and that he would be pierced. And when Jesus died, after he died, a man named Joseph asked for permission to take Jesus' body down and to bury it in his tomb that he owned. And so he and some others took Jesus' body off the cross, and they wrapped it in linens, and they put spices in it like the burial customs, and they buried it in Joseph's tomb. And they rolled a large stone in front of the tomb to seal it.
Well, you guys can stand back up. We're going to sing another song, and this song is called Trust. You guys can kind of move this way a little bit. But yeah, this song is called Trust, and I want to encourage you guys that as we are singing and praying out this song, after kind of the everything that we've heard of the story of Jesus, I want you to encourage you guys to just sing out these lyrics of trust to Jesus and who he is, because he loves you. And so we're going to sing this out. I haven't even dreamt of yet. I know that you will.
Well, as Jesus' body was taken down off of the cross, he was wrapped in linens and he was placed into a sealed tomb. Now, I don't know if you, when you think of the word tomb, what you think of, but let me just give you a picture of what that looked like. So basically, a tomb in this time was carved into like a mountain, and it was more of a cave. And then there was a stone that was rolled in front of the tomb to seal it off. Probably a stone that not just, you know, one or two men moved into place, but quite a few. It was probably pretty heavy at the time. And then once the tomb was sealed, they placed guards in front of the tomb. See, the religious leaders and the government didn't believe that Jesus was who he said he was. They thought Jesus was a liar. And so they put guards in front of the tomb in order to ensure that no one would come and steal Jesus' body. Like that the disciples didn't come and steal Jesus' body to kind of set it up to look like he rose from the dead. Because Jesus said that on the third day that he would raise himself from the dead. And so to ensure that that didn't happen or to try to put as many obstacles in place, they sealed it and put guards in the front of it. And on Easter morning, this happened. Watch this.
Oh.
after that moment, after Jesus rose himself from the dead, the Bible gives us an account of some of the things that happened. And here's what it says in Matthew 28. It says, early on Sunday morning, as the new day was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone, and sat on it. His face shone like lightning, and his clothing was as white as snow. The guards shook with fear when they saw him, and they fell into a dead faint. Then the angel spoke to the women, and he said, "Don't be afraid. I know you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead just as he said it would happen. Come see where his body was lying. And now go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead, and he is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there. Remember what I have told you." The women ran quickly from the tomb. They were very frightened, but also filled with great joy. Have you ever felt that feeling before where you're so scared, but you're so excited at the same time? That's how they were feeling. And they rushed to give the disciples the angel's message as they went. And as they went, Jesus met them and greeted them, and they ran to him and grasped his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Don't be afraid. Go tell my brothers to leave for Galilee, and they will see me there." Guys, this is why we're celebrating Easter and why this is such a celebration. See, Easter is this moment where we get to have this pause, to have this gratitude for what Christ did for us on the cross. See, what Matt described on the cross, Jesus did that for you, and Jesus did that for me. Every moment that he went through, every moment of heartbreak, every moment of pain on the cross was for you and for me, to pay the price for our sin so that we could be connected to God for all of eternity. And so Easter is this time where we remember that, and we show our gratitude and our gratefulness. And we remember how much Jesus Christ loves each and every one of us so much by reflecting on the sacrifice that he made. And it's also this time of celebration because Christ rose himself from the grave. This is what sets us apart from every other religion. Jesus is the only one who has come to earth fully God and fully human. He died a very human death, but then he rose himself from the grave, proving that he was God. No one has ever done that, and nobody ever will. And it was in his death that all of the things that we're celebrating, the fact that we can be redeemed, the fact that he was God, he can forgive our sins, that all of those things are what we're celebrating right now. And so this is an awesome time to say thank you, but then also to celebrate that this promise from God was fulfilled. Our Messiah has come, our Savior. It's also this awesome moment to understand that when we invite Jesus to come and live in our heart, when we ask him to be our Lord and Savior, he is alive. His Spirit is alive and at work within us and through us, which is such an exciting thing. We get to have this personal relationship with God. And it's not someone who's dead or unknown. No, God is alive within us when we invite him to be in a relationship with us. So this is a time to celebrate. Our Messiah has come. Our Savior did what he said he was going to do. And God, because God loves each and every one of us so much, that's why all of these things took place, is so that God could be connected to you. So Easter is all about our relationship with God and the fact that he wants to be connected to us. That's why he gave his son Jesus as this gift. And we get to be connected to him in such a personal and awesome and exciting way. Here's the thing. I don't want to end our service just right this second. I feel like we need to sing "He is Alive." Because if there's one song that we sing in JHM that really kind of represents what we're celebrating, it's this song, "He is Alive." Talking about the fact that God is alive. Jesus is alive within us through his Spirit. And we have been redeemed when we invite him into our heart and believe that he is who he says he is. So why don't you guys stand as we sing "He is Alive" together?